Scratch. I'm sure you've heard of it, but if you haven't, it's this tool that's used to teach programming to kids from the ages of 8 to 16, according to their website. It's a block-based programming language where you can connect blocks together to do various things. From moving sprites around, to making them say things, and all sorts of other weird, wacky things. You've got things like lists and variables to store information, you've got all these control blocks that change how and when parts of your script run, and you've got all these functional blocks that do things like math and other calculations. If you put this stuff together, you can make some pretty interesting things. Like I said, it's obviously meant for basic games and animations, but there are people who have made Terraria in this, and Minecraft, and three-dimensional games. Needless to say, this isn't what it's intended to be used for, but it's obviously the challenge of using something so basic that appeals to people. I, on the other hand, am perfectly content with continuing to use a game engine that makes increasingly baffling decisions. That being said, I've never really used Scratch before. I did try my hand at a 3D rendering engine. I took 2 episodes to make a triangle, a single triangle, that renders in 3 dimensions at a completely unacceptable frame rate when using Turbo Warp, a third-party tool that drastically increases the speed of Scratch programs, to run at speeds that shouldn't even be possible in the first place. So, needless to say, that wasn't going anywhere. It's not like it's not possible. Like I've already said, people have done it before, and they somehow do it really well, all things considered. But me? I struggle with some things. And I was thinking about it, and thinking about games like Snake, or Tetris, that are often used as simple starting projects for someone to get familiar with a game engine or programming language. And it occurred to me, I've never tried to do anything like that in Scratch. So I thought, why not try Tetris? I know for a fact that it's probably been done before, and I also know that it's been done better than I ever could. But that's not really the point. The point is, I wanted to know, could I even do it? So I gave it a shot. So I started by fumbling around Scratch's interface. Despite already having used Scratch before, I had somehow already forgotten how it works. Surprise? What does that do? I don't want a jellyfish. How do I make a new one? No. I figured the first thing to do was to probably make a tile sprite, because that's what 90% of the game is going to look like. After fumbling around with the costume editor, I did finally get a sprite that I was happy with. You'll notice that the sprite is white, because I intended to recolor the sprite to get the different tile colors, like I would normally do in Unity. But as it turns out, it doesn't quite work that way, so I would end up recoloring it later. The next thing I wanted was a black backdrop, which wasn't hard to do at all, after I finally found out how to make a backdrop. So now that I had a tile, and a black backdrop on top of which to draw these tiles, I obviously had to figure out how to draw a board. So Scratch has these things called extensions, which add extra functionality to it that you wouldn't ordinarily have. And the one we're interested in today is the pen extension. It allows you to do all sorts of neat drawy stuff. And the particular feature I'm interested in here is the stamp feature. It allows you to take whatever your current sprite is and just paste it onto the background. So the idea was to keep positioning the same tile sprite at each location on the grid, and then stamp it there, wherever there's supposed to be a tile. I started by trying to get the first row drawing, which I did eventually get working, and then I moved on to drawing the full board, which I set to be 10 by 20, and then proceeded to never change. I also gave the board the ability to be positioned on the screen. After that, I tried to set up tile coloring. My initial plan was to use the pen color block, because that looked the simplest. But as it would later turn out, pen color doesn't actually apply to stamping. It only applies to drawing lines with the pen, so that would have to change when I realized that. I did eventually realize that and switched to changing the hue of a red tile to get the desired effect. The next course of action was to get a piece drawing. So in Scratch, you can set the direction that a sprite is facing and then move in that direction by a certain number of pixels. So my idea was that I could set the rotation of the initial sprite to be the rotation of the whole piece and then draw the rest of the piece using stamps by positioning the tiles relative to the initial one. The problem with that is it rotates the whole sprite and thus rotates the shading. I could obviously undo the rotation before stamping and then redo it, but that just makes a lot of clunky code. Also, it would mean I'd still have to put in extra work to figure out what the tile is colliding with. Instead, I switched to a different approach. My idea was to have basically a subboard, which is basically a 4x4 board that contains only the piece that you're currently holding. The idea was I could position the subboard relative to the main board based on where the piece actually was. And if I wanted to do collision checks between the piece and the board, I could just compare tiles on the subboard to tiles on the main board. So that meant that drawing a piece was as simple as populating the correct tiles in the subboard. I did the T piece first, followed by the S piece, the S piece, then the L piece, J piece, Z piece, I piece, and finally the O piece. Next up was piece rotation. The way I decided I would do piece rotation is by just rearranging tiles on the subboard. Not actually physically rearranging the board itself, but just copying pieces from some locations to other locations. Specifically choosing new locations that would result in a rotated version of the piece. If you're having trouble picturing that, it's supposed to look something like this. What it is not supposed to look like, however, is this.
Huh?
I obviously was on the right track, I just didn't move them far enough. Something I should mention is that I plan to do rotation differently for each different kind of piece. The first kind of piece I call the 3x3 pieces. The 3x3 pieces are actually pretty easy to rotate. They always rotate around the center tile, which means the center tile never moves, and the outside 8 tiles move like a ring around the center tile. I got clockwise rotation working for 3x3 pieces first. And then I moved on to counterclockwise rotation, which also worked pretty well. Next up is what I call the 4x4 rotation style. The I piece is the only piece that uses this kind of rotation. It's a similar concept, except there is no center tile that everything rotates around. Instead, there's two rings. There's one ring of 4 tiles on the inside, and a second ring of 12 tiles on the outside. However, because it's the eyepiece, we know that 4 of those 12 tiles will never actually have anything in them, so we can skip those. I decided to do the outside ring first because it would be the more challenging one. There were some mishaps along the way, but I did eventually get it working. After that, I moved on to the inner ring, which was much simpler. Now there's technically one last style of rotation, and I call it the no rotation style of rotation. And the only piece in this category is the O piece, because if you look carefully, you'll notice that it rotates around its center, and when I rotate it around its center, you can't really tell. So you can just not actually rotate it, and you can't even tell. So that was the first day. Did I mention this took 3 days? Next up, I wanted to get a basic game loop working. It was at this point that I kind of realized I don't know how to do a proper game loop in Scratch. I fiddled around with some stuff and was having issues with timing and stuttering. But at this point, I had decided on using a 30 frames per second system. This would turn out not to be the best system and would end up getting changed later. With timing at least temporarily figured out, I got the piece falling and colliding with the bottom of the board. It's not actually true collision yet. After that, I wanted input so I could actually move the piece left and right. There were some issues. I should also mention that up to this point, my plan was to have continuous vertical movement, where the piece would smoothly move between tiles when falling. It was around this point that I decided against that. I made it to where the rate of fall was controllable, and then it was time to move on to piece deposition. That's how I'm referring to the process where a piece that is falling becomes part of the board once it lands. Now, in order to do that, I needed to be able to know when the piece actually collides with the board, which meant it's time for collision detection. And in order to have collision detection, I needed to know what tiles were on the board in what locations. So that meant making code to check the tiles on the board. And then the board ran away. To prevent this from happening again, I made some code that hard codes the board to a location on the screen whenever the game starts. Now, I was kind of losing my mind over collision detection and trying to find out why it wasn't working until I finally realized that I had typed a variable name as text instead of actually dragging the actual variable in. I'm doing the string Y instead of the actual... Okay, I feel dumb. Now, as someone who does programming in text form all the time, this was a really foreign bug to me. But in block-based programming, it makes all the difference. Because a string of text and a variable name are completely different things. And yes, this will happen again. With that embarrassment fixed, I finally had collision detection with the bottom of the board working. Because there's not actually tiles outside of the board for pieces to collide with, I made it to where if it checks for tiles that are outside the board, it just fakes it and says there are tiles there. Next up was left and right collision detection. If it checks the X and it's out of bounds, it just says there's tiles. With the ability to check for tiles on the board and know that collision is happening, it was finally time to add piece deposition. And it worked first try. Okay, not really. But I did eventually get it working. Next up, I wanted to be able to actually rotate the piece with input. And that was problematic. I was kind of losing my mind again trying to figure out why, and so I tried to make a debug draw system so that I could actually see where things were and what was happening. And that, as you would expect, worked first try. And there we go. And the problem was, can you guess it? It was the variable name thing again. Oh, I did it again. See, I told you this would keep happening. At this point, it kind of felt like my inputs weren't as snappy as I would like, so I was experimenting with using events for input. This wouldn't be permanent, at least not for the left and right inputs, because I'd proceed to revert the left and right inputs back to the way they were. With that working, I wanted to be able to control the speed that I moved the piece at. That was working fine, but I noticed it was really hard to tell where the edge of the board was. So to alleviate that, I decided to make a brand new backdrop. It's not pretty, but it does the job. Up until now, we've been stuck with the same piece, and it's been kind of boring. So I wanted to be able to randomize what the next piece was. Now that was working, but the randomness just wasn't quite Tetris-y enough. And that's because in many versions of Tetris, the next piece you get isn't completely random. If it was, you could get a bunch of pieces in a row, or go a long time without seeing a particular kind of piece. Instead, what many versions of Tetris do is they use a bag system. The 7 tetrominoes are selected to appear in a random order, but always those 7. Then, once you've gone through those, it picks a new random ordering of the same 7 tetrominoes. That way, you don't get the same piece multiple times in a row, and you don't go too long without seeing a particular kind of piece. Well, you still can get the same piece 2 times in a row, but I'll get to that later. Okay, have to shuffle a list. How do you... So I got a list of 7 random tetrominoes working, and those pieces were dropping now. At this point, I wanted to change tile IDs in the board to tile letters. It wasn't quite working at first, but I did get it eventually. With that working, I wanted to actually be able to see what the next piece I would get would be, just like real Tetris. My idea for that was to basically reuse the piece drawing code, just instead of drawing the current piece, it would draw the next piece. Now, because of the way I coded everything, doing that required some jank to be performed. Oh, what, okay, we can't rotate anymore. And the pieces are still chopped off. Oh, that's not... what? But it did eventually end up working. Eventually. As I was working on that, I noticed that it was still possible to get the same piece 2 times in a row. And that obviously happens when the last tetromino in the previous bag is the same as the first tetromino in your next bag. So just because I didn't really like that, I ended up fixing that. The next thing I wanted was soft dropping, where you could drop a piece at a rate faster than gravity. It was around this point that the weaknesses of the timing system I was using were starting to show. And because of that, I switched to a delta time-based system, where the forever loop would run as fast as it wants to, and time would be kept by keeping track of how much time passed between forever loops. With that change in place, I finally got soft dropping working. I wanted to work on hard drop next, and after that, I wanted to have a ghost piece display where your piece was going to land. And for both of those, I would need a feature that could project the current piece down onto the board and show where it was going to land. I decided I would call that scan down, and I worked on that next. With scan down working, hard dropping was pretty easy to implement. After that, I wanted to work on the ghost piece. It's the same concept as hard drop, except instead of actually moving the current piece, it just performs a scan down and draws a transparent version of the current piece at that location. It was kind of working at first, but not quite. Yeah, set ghost effect to 0 and restore the piece Y. That was one of the- oh no, it doesn't fall anymore. I did eventually get it working just fine. It was around this time that I noticed certain rotations of your pieces wouldn't look right at the bottom of the screen, so I attempted to fix that. It took a few tries, but I did eventually get it working by just scooting the whole board upwards a little bit. By this point, it was the end of day 2, I came back the next day to hopefully finish it up. At this point, it was starting to look more and more like Tetris. Of course, it was still missing a very, very crucial feature. There was no line clearing. Literally the main game mechanic that makes Tetris Tetris still hadn't been implemented yet. And so I needed to work on detecting when a line was cleared. My idea for this was really simple. For each row, just scan from left to right, and if it saw a tile that wasn't filled in, it would know that that line wasn't cleared. If it made it all the way to the right without detecting any empty tiles, it knows that line needs to be cleared. After not too long, I got the first full line detected. I wanted the line to blink, but that came with some issues. Soon enough though, I did get it working. Of course, you can clear multiple lines at the same time in Tetris. In fact, you can clear up to four. It's called a Tetris. So that meant the next thing to do was to get multiple lines clearing at once. Now, for some reason, I decided to do this in a really weird way. Rather than just making a new list, I decided to store this information about which lines were cleared inside the piece subboard, which sounds like the last place that information would belong. But if you really think about it, it's not technically being used while the line is being cleared. So no harm, no foul? Like I had done with the entire board earlier, I wanted to change the piece numbers in the bag to piece letters, so I went ahead and did that. I had one last thing I wanted to do before I would call the project good enough, and that was lose detection. As you probably know, once you run out of room in Tetris and your next piece can't actually fit on the board, you lose. And the solution to that seemed pretty simple to me. I already have collision detection working, so I figured I'd just check for collision anytime it spawns a new piece. And sure enough, that worked good enough. With lose detection in place, I felt it was finally Tetris enough for me to call it done. Of course, there's no levels and there's no score, it doesn't get faster or anything, but it's still functionally Tetris, so I called it quits there. That's not to say that it's good Tetris. It's still got some jank, and I'm not perfectly happy with how it feels, but that wasn't my goal going into this. I just wanted to see if I could make Tetris at all. And I did make something that resembles Tetris, so I guess I'd call that a success. What about you? What do you think? I'll put a link to it in the video description if you want to try it out. With that out of the way, I think it's finally time for me to move on to bigger and better things, like making something that's not Tetris in something that's not Scratch. I had fun, but I'm definitely ready to move on. Thanks for watching!